So I'll come back to that in just one second. The grant is a disparate formula grant, and Joliet and Will County are linked together in that. I also provided you the allocations. This year's joint allocation is $56,296. Probably for the last 8 or 9 years, we've split that 50-50 with the City of Joliet, which to still today, I think is a fair split. The beginning allocation is much higher for the City of Joliet, but since we provide their incarceration and court services, we think it makes sense to split it. So that 50% is $28,148 this year. What we're recommending is that we use this to continue our heroin education program. In 2013, we used it to fund the program in the Valley View schools in Bolingbrook and Olneyville. 2014, we used the JAG grant to fund our Narcan program. And then our 2015, we used for Plainfield schools. So we think that's a good use. It's limited dollars. Unfortunately, this number keeps dwindling each year. But for the amount of money, we can do some good and hopefully leverage some other benefits out of it. So we're recommending that it be used for that. And I'm going to go through the process, a couple of items we need to approve, but quick explanation of this year. Based on previous years, we thought we could just do one series of high schools. So we were looking to do this in the Lincoln Way schools, which we can do that. But a good problem to have is Robert Crown, who we've worked with before. They're a well-known health agency. They're actually doing it cheaper each year. So this year we had a good problem to have is they had basically $10,000 left of the grant, which all this is done kind of on the fly because you get the announcement and you have a very tight window to get it through our board process. So as recently as this week, we've been working with trying to identify some other schools, and we just got word between last night and this morning that we can also do this in the Wilmington School District. So we're going to propose that we do it both in Lincoln Way High Schools and the Wilmington, since it's a unit district, they have the high school and the junior high. So we still need to finalize the budget on that. So ultimately, I'm going to ask you to make a recommendation today to the executive committee if we could, and then hopefully by Thursday we'll have that all finalized, and then that Thursday they can move it to the full board and we'll take action at the full board meeting. So I'm going to just touch on a couple of the process items and then taking questions. With this grant, there's a number of steps we need to take. Number one is passing an IGA with the City of Joliet that officially distributes the money 50-50. So if you have that attachment, that's one action item. The second is the formal approval or recommendation today, and then the formal approval by the board at the board meeting. And then we've already worked with Melissa in the County Board Office to schedule a public hearing so that notice has been posted and will be posted again so that we can have a public hearing that's required by the grant. And then ultimately, as soon as we finalize the application, which hopefully will be by Thursday, we can put that up online, and that will remain online for up to 30 days, probably longer, so that the public can comment. Because we approve it, we send it to DOJ, they wait until you've had at least 30 days of public review, and it'll probably be longer, and then they'll ultimately approve it. So what I need is today is action on the IGA, and then a recommendation from this committee to hopefully executive, and then a whole board on the 16th will have our public hearing and approve it. So I know there's a lot of information, but
why is the public hearing required for that grant?
I think it's just because it's federal money, and right. They expect the public would have a chance to, and it take an additional step of in public input. We've never, I don't believe, had any public comment at any of the public hearings we've done, but it is posted. It's posted in the paper. We allow people to submit comments both electronically, verbally, in writing, but we've never received any comments. We have had in the past.
We have gotten kudos. We did get people saying, you know, good work.
Right.
If the camera wasn't running that guy, I'd tell you what I really thought. Public comment when you're doing something good. Granted, edited. When you're doing something good that's going to benefit, I just don't understand the wisdom for.
Well, it doesn't have to be a criticism. And people could say, we think you should be. I mean, they could say this is great use of money, or they could say, instead of using it for heroin education, you should use it for equipment purchases. And we have used it for a variety. When we used it for drug court, that was before drug court had their own funding. When they got their own funding through the court fees, we were able to shift that money to other folks. But The other thing I did mention is, this is part of, and some of you know this, is part of a larger heroin prevention program. We've been doing the forums every year. Last week at Public Health, we presented information on a grant we're seeking for opiate prevention. We believe that that position, it's a funded position. When it goes away, the position goes away, we said that. But this position could help coordinate some of this stuff, because there is a lot of legwork when you're dealing with schools and law enforcement agencies. So we're hoping that if that grant's successful, it ties in nicely with all this.
Okay. And that proves that.
Yeah, my question, I just wanted, this grant is so old, it has whiskers.
Yeah.
And when it started out, there was controversy over how the money was spent. And when you had your public hearing here, people actually showed up, and they argued their case. But the money has never been so large. The amount of the money has never been so significant. You can address every issue. So I just want to make that point.
Yes, Steve.
Yeah, my friend. Can you kind of explain, because, you know, like when you're doing all Lakeway schools, $28,000 doesn't pay for one person for a year to do a program or for 6 months. Can you kind of explain where the money goes and how the program works?
It isn't funding a position per se through the JAG grant. This is funding Robert Crown, which is obviously a large health organization known for their public health education. They have developed a program that's largely online, so they have one of their staff who does this all over the Chicagoland region, trains the trainer, so to speak, trains teachers to present the program. They have online modules, and that's why I think the cost is coming down, because they've developed it now. It's not like they're a profit-making entity. They're just developed the software. They have licensing and things like that. So they're training the trainers, and then they leave. So it's really coming in and working with the schools as part of their public health, or their, yeah, public health curriculum, I guess. And in Wilmington, they're going to do it, hopefully, both in the junior high and the high school, so they get 2 years of this. At Lincoln, where we're going to just do it in the high schools. And our vision is to roll this out to other high schools and junior highs around the county. We've done it, like I said, Bolingbrook, Romanville, Plainfield. But it's a train-the-trainer program, and then as of now, we're funding this kind of initial rollout to the schools, and then it's on them whether they want to continue it. The cost is very, very cheap for them to keep it going, but understandably, schools are loaded up with a lot of mandates, and if they can't do it, then they can't do it. But we are hoping that the schools will continue this on in the future, even after our funding of this grant ends. So, because it's literally $5,000 maybe to keep it going, but some districts just feel like they don't have the time in their curriculum. So
I just have a couple things. Are you going to be able, do you believe that we'll be able to do two different districts like that with just the 28,000 this year?
Okay. Yeah. And I was pretty pleased that we had extra money. So.
Yeah, that's, I didn't think we'd be able to do two. And then secondly, I guess we can direct this fund in the future if it continues. I'd like to see us at some point maybe consider, we continue running with issues with adult redeploy, things like that.
Right.
Do we have an option based under this to use that for that type of program?
You know, I have to research that. Okay. I think it's possible.
I just didn't know. After I read through the information that you sent, it looked like we could.
Right.
I'm not saying this isn't a great program, but.
The thing we've wrestled with in the past, and this goes back to 2005, 2006, was do we do programs that are going to be sustainable programs year after year? Because this money has been as hot. Well, during the stimulus, we had, I think, over $100,000, maybe $200,000. There's two awards that year. But generally, this has been a declining revenue. We were at 40, then we were at 30, now we're, you know, below 30. So in the short term, yeah, we could do that, I think. I'll check. But what we've done is technology purchases, just because we didn't have all the funds to, you know, buy iWins and in-car cameras.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of, there's some things that DOJ tries to direct you to. I mean, one of them was mental health services, because I read that and I thought, oh, right, we could maybe use it for that. But it's just that it's not, I mean, every year they're consolidating funds at DOJ and shrinking the pool of money. So, and this is formula. There is competitive grants that we're pursuing too at DOJ, but
that's a small amount of money.
We'll look and see if
it really is. But I guess my as you're talking and I'm listening, you know, I think sustainability is an important issue. And if we're going into these school districts and doing this for a one-time shot and then we're gone, I don't know if that's really where the best value might be. Is if we were able to do it with a program that's continually providing services for
the danger. Community. The danger is, and someone asked me that question, and we could definitely do this. We could next year, instead of funding new schools, we could go back in and fund the other schools that we've already done. The danger with that, though, I think in the spirit of a lot of these federal grants is you pilot them through the grant, and then you decide, do you want to continue it or not? I mean, that was the basis for the COPS hiring program years ago, I think back in 1996, whenever it was you hire these officers, the feds pay for the majority or all of it, but then after two or three years, you as a local municipality or county, you pick it up. And I just don't know if we want to get in the business of, I mean, it's your direction, but us funding these programs forever and ever, because then we're becoming the provider of the program.
When you say these programs?
For the heroin. Because it was frustrating, one of the districts is not continuing it this year.
Yeah.
And I thought for the amount of money, it's not a lot, and I know there's lots of competing priorities, but heroin deaths is a major epidemic here, and we're all focused on this, including the schools. So this seems like maybe a higher priority than some of these other competing interests. But if we want to do it, we could fund continuing programs or do a portion for a new program and a portion for, like the $10,000, we could have used that for refunding or funding additional years, but I don't know that as a policy.
No, I don't think it's our responsibility to fund. What I would actually,
especially because it's such a small amount.
Yeah, I would propose and say, listen, we'll get your program started, but quite honestly, we'd like you to sign a 3-year commitment that you're going to run.
Right.
Rather than putting it back on us, let's turn it around and say, listen, we want to help your community out, but we need some. We just don't want to do this one-time thing and just go away.
Right.
We need a commitment from you that you're going to continue the program once we move on. That way, we can then go to the next school district, get them on a possible 3-year commitment. Now you've got programs that are running in multiple districts, and we know they're going to continue to run.
I think that's a good idea. Well, and going forward, we've done most of the unit districts, which are easy because you deal with one administration, you deal with both high schools, junior highs. It gets a little more complicated, but we would like to roll this out to like the Creek Moniz, the Piatones, the Beechers, the Lockports, which we have, Lockports a bigger district, but we haven't rolled it out there, but we would like to roll out this. But then you're dealing with both high school in some cases and multiple junior highs. But we would like, so we could, as we're doing that, because we're going to do that earlier in the process, so we have this hopefully set up, and then once we know, the problem is the dollar amounts, we don't know until 30 days, 45 days before it's due, so it's a pretty quick turn, but we can estimate that it's going to be in the 30,000 range or so.
All right, Steve?
Yeah, I just had one other question. The reasoning behind doing high schools as opposed to junior high, because it seems like junior high is where kids can still be influenced when they get in high school. They're hanging around with a bunch of dopeies and they're going to be doing it anyway. And if you did them in grade school, you remember when they started saying cigarettes are bad? A kid come home, see you smoking, and say, what the hell's wrong with you, Dad? You're going to dope, you're going to die. You know, that was grade school kids. You know, so, you know, my question is, why are we concentrating more? I mean, you need everybody, but why not start in junior high where you'd have a bigger impact and more impact?
Some of it is based on funding. We didn't fund this, but Forever Crown did. Troy School District, which is in the Shorewood area, and the Joliet Township High Schools, they did both. In Valley View, up in Bolingbrook, Romanville, we did do the eighth graders. To your point, that's what Forever Crown identified. In 202, I believe we're doing the
high schools and
junior.
We're doing high school and junior high. So, in a perfect world, they would do both.
Yeah.
So you have multiple years of this So you're not just getting it one time. And you might miss some kids just for whatever reason, because it's not long units of this. It's probably more kind of specialized. So, but in a, if we had the funding, we would do both. But you're right. I mean, that's why they're focusing on our junior highs too, because kids are being exposed to this at younger ages. And so, it, but it's really, it sometimes is a question of funding. If we can do both, we'll do both. And that's like why at Wilmington, because it's a smaller district, we think we can fund both with this grant money, so.
Oh, I'm sorry, Greg, go ahead.
In regards to the Narcan, and I don't expect you to have numbers on it, could you get us numbers on, I know through this grant, we had the Narcan training, and then our deputies have went out and Jeff Jars has trained different municipalities. I know I took advantage of that and had them do Wilmington and reach out to every one of my municipalities. And you know, I don't know if everyone on this committee or every county board member knows to contact Jeff and to have them, but do we know which municipalities in the county have been trained and have not been trained?
I believe, and Anastasia's in the audience, she can correct me, but I think virtually all of our law enforcement have been
really
trained.
Okay.
But one of the things we talked about at public health, just for those who weren't there, the county executive's office has retained Kathleen Burke, who did the training initially. She's a very qualified health care professional, formerly of Robert Crown also. She did the Narcan initial training. That was a grant funded program. It ended, she left. Well, there are still departments that wanted refreshers or had wanted some additional people trained. So we've hired her on a basically case by case basis, small contract to do that in the interim. But she is the likely candidate we would recommend if we get this opioid grant, which that would involve further training and kind of maintenance of that program. Also tracking all the numbers, because the one thing we don't really have an absolute great handle on is how many saves there have been, how many uses there have been. That would be useful information to have here at Will County, just because we started the program with them. And also potentially expanding that beyond law enforcement to some other first responders and public health folks. So hopefully we will get that grant this fall and we can continue that. And I think that's that position that other duties assigned could be monitoring some of these programs too and trying to push them out. Because even to go back just for a second to the continuation, we've asked some fraternal organizations like the Rotary or some of these other clubs, would they sponsor their local schools? Because if it's $3,000 or $5,000, if it's just the money, there's money out there. We can find it in the charitable community. Some of it may be more just strategic decisions, but we are continuing to offer the training. And Kathleen presented this last Thursday. She has three meetings, regional meetings, where they're pulling all the local law enforcement together to do additional kind of follow-up and keep the program going. So, and she's working with, I think it's called the Tri-River Valley Training. It's a police organization that they do their training. She's working with them, too. So.
Thank you, Nick. Melissa, I wanted to ask you a question. Do we need to go forward and vote on each one of these issues, or can we vote just as a whole to approve?
You should vote individually.
We have to vote individually? So the first vote then that we'll take will be on the intergovernmental agreement with Joliet and Will County.
A motion.
Second.
All in favor? All opposed? All right. The second vote, please correct me if I'm wrong, is a formal approval for the Judicial Committee to move it to executive?
Second.
Is that correct?
If you're agreeable to that. It's recommending Lincoln Way Schools and Wilmington Schools, and we hopefully we'll have the application finalized for Thursday, which we can, it's a lot of minutia, but it's basically funding those two districts.
Okay, so the motion then needs to be to move the Lincoln Way and Wilmington School Districts forward to the Executive Committee?
Right.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? All right. And then, do we have to vote on the posted?
The public hearing.
The public hearing?
That your committee during the county board.
Nick, you had written it down in here, and I can't find it. I just want to make sure that the motion is correct.
You've approved the IGA, that authorized the county executive to execute that with the City of Joliet, and you've made the recommendation to approve that. So that's all we need. The public hearing has been posted just per the grant requirements.
So we don't need to vote on that?
No.
Well, you should.
Oh, that's fine.
It's going to be held during this committee.
That's fine.
Okay.
I'll make a motion to vote on.
Okay.
Just a second.
Second is this? We got it first?
Second.
Second, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay. And then is, there's one more issue there?
No, the last issue is just, we'll post it, and just, that's more information. It'll be posted, and if anyone wants to look at the completed application, it'll be posted both on the main county website, but you can also post on the county board website if you'd like, or have it given to you to post.
Wherever the appropriate place, I'm not sure where it will, or it should be posted exactly, so. All right, Nick, thank you for coming on, appreciate that. And we've got Phil and Dan here to stand here. Okay, discussion with the state's attorney office regarding property seizure process and policy. I know that Steve Ballage is very interested in this.
Good morning, Chief.
Good morning, how are you?
I'm Dan Bolt, from the county state's attorney's office.
Yes, and you're Mike Bolt.
That's the gold star.
I know, the gold star. My name is Dan Bolt, I'm the assistant state's attorney with Jim Glasgow's office, and I'd be happy to answer any questions that you folks have regarding asset forfeiture statewide or how we do it here in Illinois. As far as my background, I came here about 15 years ago, started in the misdemeanor unit, was in the narcotics unit for a while, our complaint office was in our felony division. A number of years ago, Mr. Glasgow put Chris Koch and I in charge of financial crimes and money laundering activities. It's as part of that that I've been involved in asset forfeiture. I'm the principal trainer for the Illinois State Police in asset forfeiture in Illinois, and I also train with the Tri Rivers Group and the rest of the police training institute in Illinois.
I guess we'll just open it up for questioning. I asked Dan to come in today because I know that there's been some discussion about property seizures, how do folks get their property back when this happens. I don't have any specific questions.
Would it be helpful, Mr. Chairman, if you give me a minute or two to give a general background of asset forfeiture in the state of Illinois?
That'd be very helpful.
Nationwide. Asset forfeiture actually started back in biblical times in the book of Exodus. I'm joking about that. Exodus 21:28 is the first time we saw it. And it basically said, hey, look, if someone's ox damaged someone's property or injured someone, it was the ox that was held accountable for that conduct, and the ox was stoned to death. So that generated the concept that property is responsible for certain types of conduct, separate and distinct from the owner of that property. More modernly, the federal government saw the drug problem with cocaine coming to the United States, and they adopted federal asset forfeiture in the narcotics world. That was the Federal Drug Asset Forfeiture Procedure Act, happened in the late 70s, early 80s. Most of the states lockstep adopted asset forfeiture in the narcotics world after that. The state of Illinois adopted it with one change, being we split cannabis out of that in the Cannabis Forfeiture Act and the Narcotics Forfeiture Act. So that's one area that we do an extensive amount of work in, dealing with drug forfeitures. Another area we work in is what's called Article 36, that's unique to Illinois. It allows for the forfeitures of certain types of property for a series of enumerated offenses that the legislature tends to change over a couple of years and adds in. Most notable there are certain felony DUI offenses. Driving when you're revoked for a DUI or suspended was added probably about 8 or so years ago. Burglary, homicide, robbery, child sex offenses. The third area of asset forfeiture in Illinois is under the Money Laundering Act. So dealing with criminally derived property from check fraud, credit card fraud, money made off type schemes, currency derived from narcotics proceeds, currency, any crime you can think of where there's an asset, that is also subject to forfeiture. The primary purpose when I teach people this is it's really another law enforcement tool to deter criminal conduct. The Department of Justice mission statement on asset forfeiture is it's employed to remove from criminals the instrumentalities, meaning the things they use to commit the crimes, and the proceeds of, meaning they commit the crime to get something, to take that away from criminals so they're not benefiting from it. Those are the three principal areas that we work in Illinois. There are some other oddball forfeiture provisions out there involving human trafficking. Not that that's an oddball offense, but it's a newer addition that the legislature gave us authority to work with. It's administered on a county-by-county basis, so it's through each state's attorney's office in each county. And I can tell you I've traveled all the way down to Cairo to teach this in Cook County, and every state's attorney's office, every sheriff's department, every local police department does it very differently. From someone who has been in the criminal justice system for a while, I can tell you I have sat in a jury box and chairwoman knows this, I have practiced in the criminal division quite a bit, sat in the jury box and talked to someone and sent them to prison for 18 months on a case, brought them back to court to fight over a 15-year-old car, and when I send them to prison, they're reasonable with me, aren't they, Reagan? By and large, I'll sit and talk to them, they look, you've got to go, you did this, you have to go along with you last time, that's the rule, and then we'll be okay. They come back and we fight over $1,000 car, and if I take that car from them, they yell and scream and carry on, and it is the worst thing that's ever happened to them. So I can tell you, as someone that's practiced in this area for 15 years, the use of asset forfeiture in an appropriate manner is an excellent deterrent to criminal conduct. I'm over at the jail flipping people all the time, turning them into state witnesses, and I hear routinely, hey man, look, I'm never coming out to Will County again. One, you send us to prison, we don't want to do that in your county. Two, if we commit a crime in your county, I know you and you will take our things away from us. If we look at it as a law enforcement tool, if applied properly, it's a very good deterrent and a good means to affect the goal of criminal justice, which is stop recidivism, decrease crime in our community, and remove criminal conduct that's going to occur, but target hardening. Make our county a place that you don't want to come into criminal acts, because there's a substantial penalty for those who do. If that gives you a little bit of background from where it started, we have to answer the questions you have or you start to. Sure. By local court rule, the asset forfeiture calls in front of a single judge. That was done many years ago, I think wisely, because while it involves criminal conduct, it's governed by the rules of civil procedure. So it's a hybridized call where you have civil law that interacts with criminal law. So it'll be a different judge as opposed to a judge in a felony call. That call happens twice a month, with the exception of some months that are 5 week months. And it was very busy. Myself and a partner are dedicated full-time to this. We have three secretaries in our unit that are full-time dedicated to it. And I would say that call runs from 9 a.m. until around 3 or 4 p.m. We don't take a lunch break, we go straight through.
You know, throughout the United States, if you read, which I read a lot of stuff, civil forfeitures are being used as a money-making way for government. And I'm not saying it's happening here. Reagan assures me in our county we don't have it. But I wanted to make sure, because, you know, there's horror stories out there where, you know, I just read one recently where a small business guy that owned the gas station was going to a bank, and he had $20,000 in cash. Now, why $20,000? I don't know. But it's not against the law to have $1 million in cash, to my knowledge, to own $1 million if you have it. God bless you. But so now he's arrested because he was speeding and they found whoever drove his company truck prior to him had pot in it. And they found the pot and they said he's a drug dealer because he had all the money. They took his money and took his truck. So in essence, this guy's put out of business because I don't know the particulars of what happened there, but I'm assuming that he needed that 20 grand to float the rest of his paychecks and all his bills. So now he's put out of business because of something that he didn't do. Now I'm sure when he went to court, he was probably found innocent. Then he has to go through a whole big monster procedure to get his money back and his truck back. So is that happening here? Not necessarily that particular case, but when you see somebody's property or money, do they have a 6-7 month wait before they get their property back or their money?
You'll be asked a couple questions. I'll try and answer all of them sort of in order. First, is asset forfeiture being shown in a negative light nationwide? The answer to that is yes. I would encourage the members of the committee to not only listen to what they hear, but also look at the source of the information from what you hear, and further to look at what motives or persons might be behind those sources. I can tell you quite recently in a similar story, anecdotally, there was a bill in Springfield to eliminate civil asset forfeiture in Illinois that was was backed chiefly by the Koch brothers and the ACLU for an unusual set of bedfellows. Their chief example of why asset forfeiture in Illinois was in fact bad and going awry was a story out of a southern county involving a grandmother whose vehicle was seized by the local sheriffs and seized presumptively improperly, and about the ban that occurred in the civil litigation process she incurred, having to go through it. When we went down to give testimony, and I actually was part of the group that did, the appellate prosecutor's office was involved and did some research into that case. What we found out was, in fact, that that grandmother owned four or five vehicles. She did not drive. She had three or four children in the late teens to late 20s that lived with her. One of those children had been stopped by the police for both drug offenses and driving on suspended based on a DUI on three prior separate occasions driving her vehicles. On each occasion, she was given a warning that he shouldn't drive. The vehicles were released to her very promptly. And I think in one instance, she even signed a form acknowledging he was revoked and shouldn't be driving. The fourth instance, there was a high-speed chase, and the same son offender crashed and wrecked her vehicle that he'd used the three prior times. She then went out the following week and purchased a brand new vehicle, and the son was finally caught a fifth time driving that vehicle, committing a eligible felony. The police did properly seize that car, and she was subjected to litigation. Once we learned those facts and made the legislators aware of that, that changed, I think, the discussion that we were having. And I'm unfamiliar with this case. I would tell you that in your scenario you gave me in Illinois, if cannabis were found in close proximity to that large plutonium amount of currency, there's a presumption that the legislature gave us. Presumption doesn't mean that eventually that's the fact, but that allows the government to say, this money was found in your drugs, there's a presumption they're connected. So the police would have been proper seizing the vehicle. If the individual was arrested because cannabis was in the vehicle, there's a notion of constructive possession, meaning if it's my vehicle and I'm driving it and there's drugs found in it, I'm constructively in possession of it. So the police would properly have arrested that person for possession of cannabis. Whether or not my office would eventually have charged, that's a different story. You know, the police make arrests on scene, we review those the next day or in the next couple of days for possible criminal charges. Depending on those facts, the criminality of that may have taken a different path. I don't know where this occurred.
Well, I was asking about the money. They took the money.
As far as the seizure of that $1 million, the police may properly act and seize that money in Illinois, at least, based on the presumption that a large amount of currency was found near a forcible substance in cannabis. What happens next is your question. We go to court within 14 days, which is a change we did legislatively about two or three sessions ago to solve a problem that was happening in Cook County. In Cook County, there were instances where people would go through the litigation process for 6 months before they'd actually be in front of a judge and have some sort of meaningful hearing. That was not happening in our county. We're dealing with, remember I just mentioned, with three statutory areas, drugs, Article 36 and money laundering. In the drug world, there's a requirement that the state's attorney review those facts after the police present them to us, and there's a strict time frame they must do that presentation. That was 52 days. This new statute added an additional requirement to that, that within 14 days of a seizure, we appear before a circuit court judge, we file a petition, and the judge makes a probable cause determination. If probable cause exists, that property may be subject to forfeiture. Also, the state's attorney has the authority in these cases to review facts. You think of a couple of lawyers that will actually call our office and say, hey, I had a client who had something seized. Can I meet with you and discuss these facts? And many times they'll bring some facts to our attention. In your example of the business, for instance, someone has a business vehicle that was seized. Sometimes the lawyers will come and say, look, this is a truck that's owned by Ameren, or this is a truck that's owned by People's Gas. All right, let's take a look at that. We've also had instances where the lawyers brought facts that this truck is owned by ABC Corporation. And then when I run a Secretary of State inquiry, what we found out is that Reagan Freitag is the owner of ABC Corporation. She's also the offender who was found with a kilogram of cocaine. Well, it's a clever way of trying to... Reagan Freitag does not have a kilogram of cocaine. That's an example. That would be a scenario where quite frankly, it's a scenario where a smarter criminal defendant or a smart defense attorney tried to pull, like Reagan Freitag, tried to tried to set their client up to protect those assets. And in fact, that's a sham, right? That's a farce. If I'm the offender and something's in a corporation, corporate law says I'm liable for the acts of the corporation because I know about them. Or rather, the corporation's liable for my acts because I'm the corporation. So in those instances, yes, we do, my office will meet with any attorney who comes in, or we have pro se litigants that come in and say, look, my vehicle was seized, I don't know anything about it.
Kind of where we're at here in our county, we passed a ordinance or resolution, I don't remember which one, probably about a year ago, that if your property is seized and you go to court, you're found not innocent or not guilty. There's not a different terminologies for different meetings, but say you're not guilty, and then you can ask the judge for your money back and all or your property back, and the person is made whole. Because we were talking at that time about cars being seized and you have administration towing and storage, and if they're not guilty, they still had to pay more. Now we made it where they can ask the judge if they're innocent to get it back. Well, and it's the same, almost the same type of thing. So now if a person has their property seized and they go to court and they're not guilty, then like I just heard on the radio this morning, the IRS improperly took a bunch of money from citizens. And then when Congressman Roskam got involved to try to get the money back, they were told by the IRS that the money had just dissipated throughout the system and they can't get the money back. And I'm listening in my car and I'm thinking, if I don't pay my taxes, I'm going to jail, or I'm going to get a fine, or they're going to take something. But they can take my money illegally, and you know, and just what I'm, you know, and then all these, you never hear a good side of this. Everything is about taking the way we do it now and saying, all right, well, the police no longer can take a share of the money, so it don't become a money-making scheme. And I'm not saying it is, because I believe Reagan's a good friend of mine, and she tells the truth. but it's real upsetting to read all this stuff all the time, and then know in the county, which I'm a county board member, that I may or may not be doing anything about it.
I can't speak with a former friend about the Treasury Department. I think they operate in a different world than we do. I can speak to the ordinance. I'm familiar with that. You're talking about another parallel process. So in the scenario we talked about earlier, where there was currency seized in a vehicle, cannabis found in the vehicle, there's going to be a criminal case pending, and whether or not someone's found not guilty at trial or is eventually enters a plea or is found guilty. There's also a second path, which would be the asset forfeiture case, which would be pending in our civil division, or pending in our asset forfeiture division. In that instance, there's an issue of burdens, too. There's a different burden. It's a civil burden, so it's a lesser burden than our criminal burden, which the system has always said, you know, a liberty interest is the most highly protected interest in the country, so we always protect that beyond a reasonable doubt standard. Since our founding fathers have been in existence, and formed this country, they said that property interests would be a lesser protected interest, and we protect those at an asset forfeiture level to a probable cause standard, to a preponderance standard. What you're talking about is the Will County Ordinance, which would be a third separate, essentially penalty that's being imposed on an offender. If an offender is used a vehicle for certain enumerated offenses, they also have to pay to the county a fee or a fine.
Yeah, so I was
about $500, I think.
What I was trying to get at, Rob said, I'm not a wordsmith.
Sorry.
But what I was trying to get at in that ordinance, it says that the people are made whole. Well, when it's a different scenario where cash is seized or a home is seized or any type of situation other than that, are they made whole, or is there fines for or fees taken out for because you have to work the case, or is there a fee taken out for, you know, and where, in other words, I'm innocent, but I still have to pay a portion of the money that you took when you shouldn't have took it?
I think I understand your question now. With relationship to your ordinance, that will allow someone to get money back from a payment of a Will County ordinance in that case. As it relates to the state statutes, under Article 36, there's no additional payments that would be required to be in the case. So you would receive, let's say, after a trial, the judge says, no, I don't think that money is from the sale of narcotics, it's not related to the drug trade. You would receive back anything that was seized by the police. That's your question.
there's no fees or fines or nothing else?
No, there are no fees or fines under the drug and money laundering statutes. Statutorily, claimant must either post a cost bond, which is 10% of the value of the property, or on the alternative, they can file an affidavit of indigency, which the chief judge would review and determine that they didn't meet the requirements and would waive that requirement to post the cost bond.
If they put their bond money back, they're not guilty, so.
Well, guilt and innocence is a different, guilt and innocence only deals with your criminal conduct. With the asset forfeiture, remember we talked about the ox early on? There is no guilt or innocence of a party, it's the property that has been tainted in some way. You would get back all of the property, and then the cost bond would be returned to you minus the 10% fee that the clerk keeps, which is by statute. So
the clerk keeps. That's where I have a problem. Why should you be, you know, first off, if you're not, what's the proper term, not guilty or innocent?
In a criminal setting, there would be a finding of not guilty if there were a trial. In the asset forfeiture section, the guilt and innocence doesn't come into play at all.
Okay, well, that makes it real interesting. If in an asset forfeiture case, if a person is found that the, not a person, the property is found that it wasn't part of a problem, and then they are going to be returned to the owner, the ox will be returned to the owner, the money, the house, whatever. And but because you're the owner and this stupid ox was in the wrong place at the wrong time, you got to pay 10%.
Not 10% of the value of the property. There's a cost. Well,
10% of the cost, but you still got to pay something when, and then go through all the time and effort, because frankly they're trying to convict your animal or your house or your car or your money of something wrong. And so now when they couldn't convict that property of being wrong, we still charge a fee for handling 10%. So I was in the wrong place, or my car was in the wrong place at the wrong time, or I went to the bank and I took money out at the wrong time, and so now I got to pay it because I got pulled over or they thought I was doing something wrong and I wasn't. Then they're going to take my property and charge me 10%.
Dan and I will give you a little.
Why do I need to know? Because I got a lot of negative things going on in my mind about government seizing property and then giving it back and taking a cut. I mean, the mafia used to do that too.
Let me step in there for just a moment, Steve. I understand that you have some specific questions, and we invited Dan and today to try to address some of those questions. We're out of time today because we've got our next committee. So,
Mr. Chairman, I'm available if you'd like me to stay after the effort to speak with any member of the panel.
Thank you very much for coming in. I appreciate you coming in and taking the time today. Obviously, I'm just trying to address one of the statements. You know, this is not a scam to make money. To say, hey, there's a 10% fee for whatever it is. It's not the government getting rich off of people. But, and I think that's one of the concerns that board member Ballage has. So, but I appreciate you coming in today. I'm sorry to have to cut you short right now in the middle of this conversation. But we do have another committee that's going to be meeting in just a few moments. And I'd like to go ahead and move on.
Very good. Thank you for your time, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you for coming in. Very
helpful.
There's no other new business. Any public comment? Going once, twice, three times. No chairman's report, executive session. Can we get a
motion?
Second. All in favor? All opposed? Thank you very much. We'll be meeting July 5th. No, July.